Yep, this is the question I get from every new hire. All right, how do you build that in your process? And, oh, they don't ask this to day two or three, whatever, based on what their flow of learning is, then make sure they get that information timely there to help. I mean, it's nice that they feel comfortable, but as you said, it also can detract. And as quickly as you want the new hires to be effective, you also don't want to make your current employees ineffective.
It's that time of year where the holidays are around, and we are onboarding seasonal employees to make sure that we can actually cover the demand within our hourly wage organization. So my question for you is, how fast can you actually onboard these seasonal employees without overwhelming them? Today we're going to be covering exactly that in today's webinar, on how to onboard seasonal staff in bulk, but making sure that they're well assimilated and aligned with the company from the very beginning. I'm joined today with Leslie Wireback. She is the founder of Wireback Works, and she is coming on to share some insight, so stick around. That idea of quickly onboarding employees, right? That's a huge, huge focus, especially within these hourly wage industries. So when it comes to seasonal hires, what's the biggest challenge or misconception HR actually comes across typically?
So I think the biggest challenge is volume and time. So, you know, it's a quick push for hiring generally a large quantity of employees. Mm-hmm. So even when it's anticipated for upcoming holidays or for the summer, you always have to ramp up. It's still a push. Like, you can only do it in such finite time period. I think the misconception is that it can be done faster than any other regular hiring and onboarding. There's not too many shortcuts you can take. You're still working with people in that process, and it has to happen. I know we might talk a little bit more about where you can find some efficiencies or less time in the onboarding, but overall, the hiring process is still the hiring process.
Absolutely. In terms of onboarding in bulk, I want to get into that a little bit more. Can you share some of those best practices for actually streamlining the onboarding process when it comes to bringing on more than just one employee at a time, right? We're talking 10 to maybe even 15, or maybe even sometimes less, but talking in bulk, right? So what are some best practices there?
Yeah, I think key best practice is making it consistent and repeatable. Mm. So thinking about, you know, we have this time frame where we have to onboard 10 to 15 people at a time. Mm-hmm. What can be consistent and repeatable with that? If you, at 10 people, is everybody still able to learn and be engaged? If we get to 15, what's lost? Or is 15 still a reasonable number? I have clients where they have a regular schedule of it. This is how they go through the volume. So on this week is when everybody starts. They do this on this day. So they have it consistent. Mm-hmm. So that anybody involved in onboarding is able to plan for it and be able to make the new hires feel welcome.
Definitely. Definitely. I want to point to this very first slide that we've got here. It talks a little bit about tips to streamline your onboarding process. It's actually a really great article from GGA Solutions. I'm curious, you know, what are your thoughts on this, Leslie, in terms of, you know, looking at these top four tips, identifying essential skills, then breaking it down, then utilizing technology, and then providing hands-on experience? Does this kind of fit the format that you would maybe follow with clients?
It does. So I actually really loved this. And when you shared it with me, thinking, I don't know what I would change.
Right.
So kudos on the source of this, but really, you are talking about the skills. What do you need to have them know? Mm-hmm. I like the modular approach because, again, as we talked earlier, you can't take out everything. You know, you still have a core you have to do, but maybe there are pieces that don't apply. So how can you break that out? As well as, you don't want to overwhelm the new people. So the module for that is great. And, you know, bringing in technology so that it's simple and for the new hires, as well as the HR departments and managers administering it. And of course, hands-on, like if all they're doing is sitting there learning in front of a computer, it's not going to be very effective and people are going to be bored.
Yeah, definitely. I love the aspect of making sure we're not overwhelming the employees, right? Especially those that are coming on who might be brand new, you know, maybe they're not returning employees per se. They're brand new to the company. You know, they're learning the skills, the tricks of the trade, and identifying those essential skills. I really think that that is so important, and making sure, hey, we're filling those skills with this employee specifically is absolutely key, right? Looking at those as a, you know, bullet point suggests those core competencies. I think that's so important.
Right.
Within hourly wage industries, obviously employee turnover is very high, as we said. How can HR actually ensure new hires become productive team members pretty quickly, even if they're only there for maybe a couple weeks, months max?
Yeah. So I would again go back to what's essential to start. So maybe for that first week, they only need to do this piece of the onboarding. You know, they don't need their, if it's like a safety certification, they don't need that in week one because they're shadowing or whatever. So do what is only essential to start and can make it most efficient. So instead of presenting like for the whole first day, this we're going to go through everything. What if it's a small block each day for a full week so that they can get to work quickly, and you also are meeting all the expectations of giving them the knowledge and skills to be effective.
Absolutely. And again, like we said before, like making sure that those core competencies, excuse me, are identified, they're set in stone, and it's easy for that employee to say, okay, this is what I need to learn first and foremost. And, you know, maybe skills following are more nice to haves at that point, and they'll pick them up naturally along the way. So yeah, I think, again, setting up that kind of syllabus style of training, making sure that, hey, we have something for every day of this week for the employee to learn, to be able to grow in terms of whatever skill you have identified as those cores. Awesome. In terms of technology, digital tools, do you recommend anything for automating and just kind of accelerating that onboarding process? I know we kind of talked about you can only get so quick with these onboarding processes. Do you recommend any technology there?
So my recommendation is always to use the tools and software you have. So I wouldn't want anyone to say, oh, I can't make my process more efficient because I don't have this new flashy software. But you have something. You know, I've seen people use Google Forms really effectively to get at least basic information. Obviously not maybe all the confidential information, but utilizing what you have, how can you leverage that? Putting your onboarding within the software and automating the process flows and signatures would definitely be that next step. Mm-hmm. So that it, in essence, your checklist is there automated. They can't get to this next step unless they've submitted the first one, you know, so that all of your compliance happens. You know, they don't get all of this information perhaps until they've passed the drug test. And then from that, what's the next one? And make it flow there. I think also giving access to the people who need it. I've seen it where it's too controlled by human resources, and yet there's different pieces within onboarding that the manager needs to be a part of it. And so making sure that everyone has the right access at the right time so that that flows. And again, technology can help with that based on permissions, access, everything like that. And then tailoring it to your employee base, you know, seasonal, probably much more quick, perhaps a younger audience, use a mobile app for easier accessibility. Also, you know, I've seen where they can upload their IDs easier, faster. So I've seen some technologies that do that really well, others where it's kind of like you're fumbling along and a typical technological user would not be able to figure out how to do it. So it's that easy. I even experienced it. I was doing like contract work for someone and I was like, oh my gosh. And they're like, why haven't you done this yet? It's like, cause I have to go get my passport, take a picture, upload it. Like it wasn't easy.
Yeah.
It wasn't a snap from my phone, upload, you know, a nice quality picture of my passport. And that slowed me down.
Yeah, definitely. I really like the point that you made on making sure that we're pairing up technology and, you know, human interaction, HR management together and not just relying completely on technology. You know, we've, especially on our side, on the software side of things, we've seen our fair share of horrible UI UX, horrible design of a product and making it actually so much harder to upload your documents, all that stuff, where we've taken all that into account. We actually had, I was talking to John, he is an HRS manager over at Reef Parking, and they onboard a ton of employees. I want to say anywhere from 1,000 to 2,000 employees during the summer seasons. They have a lot of fluctuations there. They have a lot of people coming on to help with the reef parking aspect of their business model. And John was saying how they really utilize the mobile onboarding feature a ton. You know, that's something that has, again, it allows him to really double check that documentation. It's already pre-uploaded because of the mobile onboarding feature. A lot of these employees are very equipped with technology already. They have their own phones. It's easy. It takes a couple of minutes to onboard each and every staff member. So that way, you know, managers aren't running around with their heads cut off, right? And it's huge for them. And of course, John being the head manager in this case, it's so easy for him to track, okay, who are we bringing on? And then when the time comes, we need to offboard these employees really seamlessly. And it's easy. It's all simple. It's all right there on their phone. And in terms of the management side of things, right on the desktop. So I totally hear you in terms of, you know, we see a lot of those pieces of technology that feels like more of a nice to have, where, you know, with workforce, it's a necessary requirement for a lot of our clients. You know, they need to have this or else they're not going to be able to onboard the mass amounts of employees that they have during their on season. It's crazy though. Yeah.
Well, and you made me think of, I had a client who, for whatever reason, they were still mailing the form the person needed for their drug for their drug screen. So like one, you were relying on the mail to get it there, and then you missed, like, it was a terrible delay because they had onboarding scheduled at a set, like every other week they were onboarding people, and people would miss it because they hadn't completed that step and it was the mail. So that was one of the first things of how do we make this automated so that that could happen faster. Plus people were like, I was like, you're mailing something?
Wow. I mean, that is very retro of them. I love it, but it probably takes a whole lot of time. I mean, yeah, geez, that poor manager is probably just drowning in paperwork, but yeah, you know what? Hopefully maybe they'll watch this webinar and sign on with Workforce and we'll go from there.
We'll see the possibilities.
Exactly. Exactly. We'll get them off pen and paper soon enough. Hopefully. Right. Awesome. So in terms of, you know, talking about assimilation to technology, in terms of cultural assimilation and actually aligning new hires with the company values, all that good stuff, how can HR ensure that seasonal staff actually quickly feels connected to the team?
Yeah, I think one of the greatest ideas that I see that works really well is assigning a guide or a mentor. I know some places call the person a buddy, whatever that may be in your workplace culture language, having them paired with someone. If it's so many new hires, you could make a small group, but that they have an experienced employee paired with them to help as a guide so that when they have questions, they can go to that person and not feel like they're bothering someone, not question if it's a dumb question, like I should have known this, that they have that. And I think it's critical to have them interact with staff that's not only the seasonal. So yes, you're onboarding 10 or 15 seasonal employees, but you want to make sure they're integrated very quickly with the staff that's already there so that they don't feel isolated. I always, you know, people bond over food. So as quickly as you can have lunch breaks as a social opportunity with other staff, as well as leaders, you know, that's a great time for department leader, company leader to get to meet the new employees, welcome them, make them feel part of the team, not only seasonal, but they're really integrated as a key part of the team. When you need that much seasonal help, they are a key part of your team. And then quick daily check-ins, putting that on either a manager or if that's part of the guide or the mentor, that they have these daily check-ins so that if something came up yesterday, they have that chance to ask the question, or even end of day so that they could ask the question before they go home so they know what to expect the next day.
I love the idea of a mentor buddy or somebody that they can just kind of partner up with. It's not necessarily a manager or even the HR manager, head of HR, whoever. I think it's really nice to kind of have somebody typically within their age cohort that they can kind of rely on. They can lean on a little bit for those questions that they might feel like are insignificant to ask a manager or someone, you know, who's a upper level manager. My question for you is, you know, I was talking to a friend about this, and she was saying how she is kind of that person within her role, and she works for, you know, a bigger corporate company, granted, but she's that person for, you know, all the questions that new hires come to. And I think she's that person because she's kind of allowed herself to be that person, but it's actually taking away a little bit from her job and the things that she's actually able to accomplish because she's getting so many questions from so many of these new employees that have actually come on into the holiday season. So I'm curious, you know, what would you say in terms of balancing that aspect? Because I think the last thing that managers want to do is actually take away work from those who are experienced employees, of course, from, you know, getting distracted with answering all those questions as a buddy or a mentor.
Right. I think within that, so for your friend, there's probably a reason that your friend is the go-to based on warmth, comfortability,
sure. Yeah.
Coming to them. So then what can the employer learn from that and how to make sure they are paired with someone else or that there's designated hours for mm-hmm. these questions? Like, hey, we're going to have a come ask your question time with so-and-so. This is when you can do it, or,
yeah.
you know, that it's at certain break time so that it isn't so overwhelming. And my other thought would be take all those typical questions that he or she's getting and make a frequently asked questions guide. Like, okay, yep, this is the question I get from every new hire. All right, how do you build that in your process? And, oh, they don't ask this to day two or three, whatever, based on what their flow of learning is. Then make sure they get that information timely there to help. I mean, it's nice that they feel comfortable, but as you said, it also can detract. And as quickly as you want the new hires to be effective, you also don't want to make your current employees ineffective.
Absolutely. I think that's such a good point. You know, if for our audience, obviously primarily being in HR, if you guys are an acting mentor, a buddy of some sort, yeah, check in with those buddies, right? Making sure that, hey, are you feeling like you can get your work done first and foremost? And second, you know, what maybe are those FAQs that you typically get asked? And building off of that, I think, again, this is all collateral that is not only from your frontline staff, straight from the horse's mouth, so to speak, but it's something that you can actually flip and make into PDFs or, you know, a little pamphlet of, hey, here is something that is a really great tool to actually more quickly onboard our staff at the end of the day.
Right.
Yeah. In terms of the roles that, you know, require really specific training and even certifications, possibly, what advice do you have for HR to expedite the training and certification processes without sacrificing quality, compliance, and safety?
That's a tough one.
Yeah.
I had to think about that. And in my mind, I had to think about, like, what would it be that mm-hmm. to kind of have that switch? So abbreviated version, obviously, if possible, the example I thought of is like, I know there's 40-hour OSHA training, but there's also 10-hour OSHA training. Sure. So how does that specifically apply? And you don't need to go above and beyond for the seasonal if the other one gets them started. Maybe they do it later, but this way you get them through their first 30 days, 60 days, 90 days with the lesser time frame of that. I remember there was a specific training that we had with Waste Authority employees, and we could do like an 8-hour versus a 24-hour for that. The other thought is utilizing on-demand technology. So these trainings and that onboarding, it doesn't all have to happen within the workday. So if you're leveraging technology, anything like that, the employees can view this on their own before they come in. You can record and still pay them for it, but that can help get them up to speed faster so that you're not sacrificing that in kind of, you know, if you're only hiring them for 2 months over the holidays, you don't want to spend the whole first week in training, probably, I would assume.